Good morning and welcome to the 13th meeting of the Public Audit and Post-Legislative Scrutiny Committee. This is the first time this session that a Scottish Parliament committee has met outside Edinburgh. I welcome the members of the public who have joined us today in Dundee and thank Dundee City Council for letting us use the City Chambers this morning. Can I ask everyone present to please switch off their electronic devices or switch them to silent mode so that they do not affect the committee's work this morning, and please check them if you have not already done so. Item 1, the committee is invited to agree to consider its work programme in private next week. Do members agree? Thank you. Item 2 is two separate evidence sessions on the Auditor General for Scotland's report entitled The 15-16 Audit of NHS Tayside Financial Sustainability. We took evidence on this report on the 3rd of November from the Auditor General. Given the serious financial issues raised, we decided to meet in Dundee so that people living in Tayside and using NHS Tayside services were able to hear directly from their local health board about how it is trying to address these challenges. Our first evidence session this morning is a round table with patients' groups and trade unions, where we will hear firsthand their experiences of NHS Tayside. We have three themes, each of which we will spend about 15 to 20 minutes discussing. I'm now going to ask all members to introduce themselves briefly and state who they represent, including the witnesses. Going clockwise, I am Jenny Mara and I am convener of this committee.
I'm Sonia Cottam, I'm Director of Pain Association Scotland.
I'm Gail Ross, I'm the Member of the Scottish Parliament for Caithness, Sutherland and Ross.
I'm Richard White, I'm Regional Officer for Unite the Union.
I'm Ross Thompson, Member of the Scottish Parliament for North East Scotland.
Good morning, I'm Mary Ballantyne, I'm the Chairman of Angus Cardiac Group.
Alec Neil, MSP for Airdrie and Shotts.
Bob McGlashan, RCN officer.
Monica Lennon, MSP for Central Scotland.
Good morning, I'm Maureen Phillip, the Senior Director for the Family Support Service in Tayside for PAMIS.
Colin Beattie, MSP for Midlothian North and Musselburgh.
Raina Marshall, I'm the Joint Branch Secretary of Tayside Healthcare Branch for Unison.
I'm Liam Kerr, MSP for the North East Region and Deputy Convener.
Brian Hogan, committee member of the Deaf Links.
Thank you very much indeed. The first of our three themes is performance. Can you give us an idea of what NHS Tayside means to the group you represent and your group's experience of their services? Who would like to kick this off? Don't all rush at once. Bob? Okay. Bob from RCN.
Yes. I think the key issue for performance for nurses, because primarily it's nurses, it is nurses that we represent, but in partnership we support other unions with other members of staff. But quality of care is important to the nursing profession. And I would suggest that most nurses, if not all nurses, leave home in the morning to deliver the best quality of care that they can. However, staff increasingly over the past few years have found that they're not able to deliver the standard or level of care that they're trained to do or would want to do for their patients. That's not to say that they're not delivering safe care, but they're not delivering the care to the level that they feel they would like to or indeed they're trained to do. And a number of the issues with that is to do with the current status in relation to recruitment of nurses. And that's not just unique to NHS Tayside, it's a national issue. But recruitment, vacancies, dependency on agencies and bank staff are having an impact on the working environment for nurses. And that in itself means that their priorities aren't always facing priorities for the patients and they're taken away from the direct patient care. And that is something that's having an impact on staff morale, and that's been an increasing issue for our staff, is that the morale issue has become less and less. And as I say, this is not just unique to NHS Tayside, but we really, really need to look at you know, how we make this group of staff feel valued, because at the moment they don't. They're increasing their morale, because at the end of the day we need these staff to look after ourselves, you know, and for future planning. So it is a big issue. It's not unique to Tayside, but it is an issue. But in Tayside is the recruitment. And I think one of the issues, the second issue is about agency, is the NHS Tayside, like other boards, are saying we want to reduce the amount of premium agency usage, but there is a lack of a robust process that's going to replace what these premium agencies are covering at the moment within the clinical areas. So it is a big challenge, but it is a big stress for the nursing family in relation to the stress is increasing, and, you know, people are leaving, not often because they can leave nursing through natural retirement, but people who maybe previously had ambitions to stay on within their nursing employment beyond a retirement age are choosing to leave now when they can, and they're not coming back to sort of to help out through bank or agency, well, bank nursing, and we're losing that experience at quite an alarming rate.
Bob, can I ask you, do you have members who were on an NHS contract but have now left to work for agencies and are coming back into the NHS through agency?
Absolutely. There certainly over the past 2 years there's been a huge increase in staff, particularly those that can maybe come up to retirement, who have been fortunate enough that they can retire, you know, 55, 60, who previously might have then engaged with NHS Tayside in a sort of short-term contract or a reduced hours contract, who subsequently have used the opportunity to move on to some of the premium agencies and then are coming back to work through the premium agencies as opposed to be coming back to work for NHS Tayside.
How about younger nurses?
There are some younger nurses as well who, for various reasons, you know, they're early on in their career, but they're seeing the nursing agency as an opportunity to have flexibility, whether that's just flexibility for their own lifestyle, or if it's a family sort of friendly type issue, if they've got children, that they see that there's a lot more flexibility that's afforded from an agency and or bank situation as opposed to having a contract with NHS.
And is that easy for them to do?
It has been, because like everywhere else, agencies, NHS boards, they've all been vying for the same staff that are out there, not registered nurses. There's a huge decrease in registered nurses. There's not enough, as I'm sure we all know. So everybody's vying for the same sort of recruitment of nurses once a year when there's graduation of registered nurses. So it is a competitive market, but their terms and conditions for some of the premium agencies far exceed those within the NHS.
Their terms and conditions are better in agency, yes, than in the NHS. Mm-hmm. Can you expand on that a little?
Yeah, I mean, obviously, remuneration being one, certainly with some of the premium agencies, some nurses, you know, can be earning, you know, significantly more than what the entry level for a registered nurse would be under Agenda for Change, which is the terms and conditions that we're governed under. But also the feedback that we're getting from people within some of the premium agencies, and, you know, maybe not so much, I can't comment on some of the less premium agencies, but certainly premium agencies, is the training and development is very robust as well. So they appear to be investing as well as taking the skills within the agency, but they seem to be investing quite heavily in the training and development. And that in itself is bearing benefit for the nurses, for the patients, but actually for the retention as well, because they're not struggling to recruit where other areas are because of these factors.
Thank you very much, Bob. Maureen, did you want to speak?
Yeah, just on the performance, I mean, I'm here today to represent people with profound and multiple learning disabilities and their family carers. And I have to say, since 2010, NHS Tayside in 2010 implemented an improvement plan for people with learning disabilities within the acute hospital sector. And since that plan's been implemented, I have to say it's been just one of the best things that have improved life for people with profound and multiple learning disabilities and their family carers. So from that point of view, within the acute hospital sector, for our group, it's been really, really worthwhile. My worry is that it's dependent on a few people who were at the top of NHS Tayside, and I would like to make sure that it was fully embedded so that it continued to change. Because for us, NHS Tayside, we feel are committed to the education of their staff for the future. Although it's Dundee University, we were involved this year for the first time in family carer being used to help train about 300 nursing students, and we are involved in medical students training programme every year and have been for the last 5 years. So I feel that that is really, really positive. So for me and the group I represent within the acute hospital, there's been massive change since 2010. And I mean, I know that because it's as simple as my phone doesn't ring anymore for serious issues. So from that point of view, my group, there's been such an improvement, and I wouldn't like to see that lost. I would like that to continue to grow. But what I would like to see is NHS Tayside making more use of the help that the voluntary sector can give them in the training of existing staff within the hospital. We have done that to a certain extent with technology, and they do try really hard, and we're working hard with them to pilot digital passports within the acute hospital sector, but every step of the way is hampered for them as well by their systems and getting around their systems and confidentiality. So if there was some way of removing all the restrictions that would help NHS Tayside to be even more innovative than I feel that they already are, then that would be amazing. So for the future, that would be really good. So for my group within the acute hospital sector, yes. But within the community, there are still problems, especially with technology moves so fast. And I have a lot of families now who can communicate through the use of eye gaze technology, but because the strategy for learning disability sits under mental health, equipment is the last thing to go. So when there's any funding, it's not there for equipment. So these children and young adults are not really getting what they should get. So for me, there's a bit about performance for the future that I would like to see NHS Tayside have a wee look at that and how that can be improved, just to make sure everybody is having equal access. So. And I know there is eye gaze technology within the schools, so it's not that the technology isn't there, it's more about the way that it is sort of delivered, if you know what I mean. Like, children get about 10 minutes on the eye gaze, and that isn't really long enough. So for me, a wee bit about innovative, creative thinking about how that can be looked at overall within NHS.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you. So you feel that NHS Tayside are making good use of your expertise,
yeah,
but that could be even better,
yes,
perhaps in the future?
Yeah.
Thank you. Mary?
Is it possible I'd like to add a little bit to
what
Maureen has said and the point that Bob is making about the quality of care that's delivered and the input that some of the groups can make? I represent Angus Cardiac Group. We're probably one of the most active patient-led groups, not just in Tayside and Fife, but across Scotland. And we have a 400 membership, and the majority of us all have heart disease and access primary care and secondary care at different times in the health journey. We actually know, and we're really pleased with a lot of the care that we receive in Tayside Health Board, Tayside and Fife. And we do try to work hard in partnership with them. In primary care in particular, there are a number of frustrations around accessing GPs and various things like that. There's nothing different there for us. But one of the big, I suppose, the plea from our group to this meeting is involve us more in the what do we need to do to try and improve things. Mm-hmm. We know what the frustrations are and we're happy to speak about them. We know that you don't have a magic wand and you can't fix things immediately. But without a doubt, we need to have some help for access. In secondary care, when we are acutely ill, access is immediate and the care that we receive is impeccable. and Tayside have delivered exceptionally on that. And just last week, in a different meeting, a consultant, without any prompting, made the comment that if you need something at that moment in time in Tayside, you will get it. And for a cardiac patient, that is absolutely the message that we need to hear, because there's the golden hour, if you like, from when you start to become ill to when you need to be fixed. So it's great to hear that we can have that. But in primary care, if we phone the GP to say that we feel unwell, it can take the entire day before the GP can return a call to you to explore your symptoms. Now, that conflict is actually very difficult, and we would like to somehow be involved in trying to resolve that if we can. And I think it comes back to the point that we are the people with the illness, the disease. We can offer something to help and some ideas to come together to fix it. But at that critical moment, when we're asked the question, what brings you here today and what do you want to happen, which I believe are the questions that are now being taught to the nurses and the doctors, I can assure you in the heat of the moment, there are two questions we don't want to hear. It's evident why we're there, and it should be fairly evident what we need to happen at that moment in time. And it's feedback like that that we want to work with the groups to improve the situation for everyone.
Mary, can I ask for your patients, have you had any issues with treatment time?
Waiting time is a frustration. And if you look at the situation in primary care first and foremost, so if you make a phone call to your practice and you say that you're ill in that day, it could take the entire working day for someone to come back to you. So that's just that very short snapshot of the day. However, let's just imagine at the end of that day a decision is taken that you need to see someone in secondary care, and that's then where this very long wait can come in. We know that the lead times to see the consultants or the specialist nurses or whoever it is in secondary care can be 12, sometimes 18, sometimes 24 weeks. We know that. But unfortunately, when you have a chronic condition, that 18-week period is not just the deterioration in your chronic health condition. You're also possibly acutely unwell at that point in time as well. So the waiting times are a huge frustration. They are getting a bit longer, and the feedback from the older patients in our group, Angus Cardiac Group, our average age is probably about 75 or 80. I think I'm faring quite well representing them as a youngster. But seriously, for the older patients, that frustration is terrifying. Because now, unfortunately, when they talk to me, they say things like, 18 weeks from now, I might be dead and buried. It's a lifetime. And somehow, if we could shorten that in any way, or signpost to someone else who could see you during the waiting time, I think would be really helpful, rather than that period of no one sees you and no one talks to you. So the waiting times are getting longer, but we need to find a way of inputting during that time, and then the waiting would be easier. We know it's probably impossible.
So it wouldn't be by a consultant, but maybe by a specialist nurse or...
It's whoever is
somebody in the community.
Expert needed at that point in time. In the olden days, it used to be just the consultant. But now there are so many other people in the multidisciplinary team who could be accessed during that long waiting time, who might be able to just make that time more bearable and easier for people. It's not going to cure the situation, but without a doubt, when you're dealing with people who have chronic, long-term, they are not curable conditions, they just need input of some kind that will make it bearable during that period.
Thank you, Mary. Thanks, that's very useful. I'm going to bring in Raymond Marshall from Unison, but I first want to say, if we can kind of move to the second theme, obviously, Raymond, say what you want to say, but if we can touch on the second theme, which is savings. Have you noticed any strains in NHS Tayside recently? How has it impacted your experience with the group you represent? And what do the board's current financial difficulties mean for the group you represent? Raymond Marshall from Unison.
Thanks so much. I think I just wanted to mention about the other staff that sit within NHS Tayside.
So though we have nursing, I know Bob mentioned that our staff is, it's about the admin staff and the support staff that sit there within NHS Tayside. And I think they're feeling a frustration as well, because they're trying to deliver a good service to the population of Tayside. And they're feeling that constraint on them as well, around because they're an easy target, or they seem to be an easy target, to say, right, well, here's the staff within Tayside, and everyone says, oh, and I don't like the word backroom staff, because they're not backroom staff. I mean, they're delivering a service, and if it wasn't for them, a lot of the services wouldn't run. So I think that they're feeling that they're an easy target, and there's a reduction there. I mean, if I was to go on to the savings and mention something on that sort of...
Please.
So, yeah, so, I mean, I just think that there is an increased financial strain on NHS Tayside, and it's been there for a number of years now. And it does impact directly on our staff. They've been asked to do additional duties, take on additional work. They're asked to move into areas that they're not familiar with, which Bob's touched on roughly around for the nursing staff as well. And it's a massive pressure on their work-life balance as well. This is what and I think we're concerned about the pace of some of the financial elements that Tayside are trying to push forward. And one of our main concerns is around the pace about instructions that come from government around terms and conditions. So, for instance, the enhancements during leave, you're still sitting today with all staff within Tayside not being paid that what they're due in relation to the enhancements during leave. Only just last week we were approached to look at that through the group that we sit on, and they're asking us to now change the way that we approach that to enable them to achieve that by March this year. And that goes back to something that the organisations, the trade unions, had suggested back in 2012 and was dismissed.
So you have members who haven't yet received the correct enhancement during leave payments, is that right?
The majority of staff in Tayside have not received their full payment. Mm. All, I think most of the staff have received a part payment, but they've not received it all. And what we've been asked now is to change how we apply that and go back to what was a suggestion from the trade unions back in 2012, which was dismissed. And we're just looking at all that time that's been wasted and looking at that. And I think there's other small, there seems to go for big ticket items like staffing. So we had a reduction in 220 whole time equivalents within Tayside. And that produced the biggest cost saving for Tayside. But it's not a recurring, it's not. Because we've then had to take on 200, or they have employed 200 newly qualified practitioners. So that cost gets offset against that. Some small ticket items that go forward as well we're concerned with, because they just seem to be implemented without any discussions. An example of that is where they switched off the purchase of stationery, like paper, and staff were actually hiding paper because they needed it. They didn't want to leave it in the printer because someone else might print off. I mean, it's these kind of things that really, really frustrate staff, and I don't think that helps push forward the message of everybody being engaged. And I think other concerns is that through partnership working as well, we feel that sometimes we're being ignored or taken out of the loop, and the decisions are getting made by directors. And then they're asking trade unions to come in and try and take forward what they're trying to implement. So that would question for us through partnership working and the staff governance as well. So the trade unions are committed to try and help and support through partnership working to take these things forward. We were members and involved were members in those decisions.
What do you mean by staff governance?
Well, we have the staff governance standards, basically, which means that you must be, well, it's to involve staff at the start, not make a decision and then just say, right, this is what's going to happen. Mm-hmm. It's about engaging with staff and involving them in the decision-making process.
Do you feel there is a good relationship between managers, decision-makers and staff?
At the moment, no.
And has that been better in the past?
It's been better in the past, and we are trying to work through it. I mean, we've had other people coming in to support, to help support around that, but at the moment it's not as good as what it has been in the past. No.
And what could be done to make it better?
I think commitment and partnership is based on trust as well. I think that we do need to build that trust, because if you're getting decisions made without your involvement, then that sort of goes against the trust element of it.
Thank you, Raymond. Thank you. I'm keen to let everyone speak, and then I'll come back to you, Bob. Richard, would you like to speak at this point?
Yeah. My involvement with NHS Tayside as a regional officer's pretty recent. My colleague who retired after dealing with NHS Tayside for 30 years would probably say different things than what I would say here today. But the only thing I can draw in comparison is the 7 years I spent dealing with NHS Highland. In NHS Highland, I don't think I ever litigated. I never had a ballot for industrial action, with the exception of the public sector's pensions dispute, which was UK-wide. Sadly, that's not the case in NHS Tayside. I have litigated. There was a 16-week porters dispute, which was before my time, but that was a very significant dispute. There have been other consultative ballots about management attitudes towards their staff in terms of dignity at work. And I feel that something is wrong in terms of the internal culture that requires strong leadership and a stronger partnership working to address that. I think there are difficulties at middle management level, and I think Bob and Raymond have both touched on some of how that translates to our members working in the front line, given one of the most valuable public services that anybody can give. There is a stretch on people to work beyond the terms of their job remit. That causes frustration. And there's a deep suspicion about the way gradings were done historically, which led to the Porters dispute. So we've got a difficulty for sure with morale and hearts and minds. And I think the financial pressures that are coming on make that very, very serious. I also deal with many other employers. I have seen what the financial impacts of austerity have had on local government, and how the changes in services are made that don't actually improve the level of service delivered to the public. It's a reducing cake. It has an impact where you lose, there's a brain drain, where your expertise and your committed people leave. And I think Bob touched on that with relation to some nurses drifting into agency work because their hearts and minds are lost, and it's an easier option to pick and choose your shifts. And I think there's a serious concern for the future if we don't package it all together and work jointly and strongly together to change the culture and to deal with things moving forward.
Richard, could you address the financial difficulties of the board specifically and any specific impact on your members?
I think when you... Dundee's a relatively small city, and I know we go beyond Dundee, but in terms of Dundee, Nine Wells is a big hospital with most of the employees there. People work in the NHS, people work in the council. In Dundee City Council, we've come through 4% budget cuts, and everybody is in a very miserable state and waiting to see what the announcements from today in Edinburgh will be, with fear and trepidation about another 4%. When you look at 5% over 5 years, £175 million of cuts, that is quite an astonishing thing to be looking at for people. And I think that's where the concern comes from. If they know what 4% in 1 year did to Dundee City Council last year, what does 5% 5 years in a row mean for NHS Tayside? That's a concern.
Does Unite have ideas about how they can help the board achieve efficiency savings and maintain a standard of service?
We've seen the work streams. We are involved, as our sister unions, in the work streams. One comment would be that prescribing stuff has been a target for financial saving for a considerable number of years, and it seems to go up. And I don't think that's just NHS Tayside, but I think NHS Tayside's a bit of an outlier on that. It does seem that there could be something done about that. but I'm unsure as to how it's not been achieved to date. The other issue is about agency, of course, but the problems with morale don't help when you have an exit door, a revolving door with people coming back in as agency. That doesn't help. Unless you address the internal issue, you're still going to get a difficulty in having posts filled, people staying in these posts, committed to working long term, and you'll have to rely on agency. So you have to kind of fix everything at once, I think, with regards to that.
Thank you very much. I'd like, Bob, did you want to come in?
I was going to cover, the only thing I was going to add was in relation to staff governance that Raymond had mentioned. You know, staff governance has principles both for employers and for employees. And certainly, you know, I strongly believe that the staff governance principles are good principles, they're common sense principles, and if they're applied, they're quite effective principles. But certainly, from members that we've had contact with over the past two years, the feeling is that the only governance that there is around the staff governance is the members' responsibility, and there appears to be a lack of seriousness given to the organisation's responsibility under staff governance. And I think if that was redressed, that could help, because it's about involving people. I don't think anybody's silly out there. They know that there's financial constraints. There's no, there's got to be savings. But a lot of the savings are dictated from top down, whereas I'm a strong believer some of the savings can be identified by our members that are on the ground floor, but there's not that engagement with them to say, well, you know, have they got any ideas how we could be more efficient, still provide a good service, but save waste? And I feel that's something that needs to be redressed and has been lost.
Thank you. Brian.
My name is Brian Hogan. I'm with Deaf Links, and I'm representing deaf people in the Tayside area. This is a tiny snapshot compared with the millions of pounds that we've been speaking about. It's to do with sign language interpreting and the services that are provided by the NHS and their local interpreting agency. In the past, deaf people have been seriously neglected. Deaf people have had hospital stays for 2 weeks, and not once was there an interpreter present to explain to them what was going on. They didn't know what the operation was, and they didn't give consent because they didn't know of what's being said to them. Over the years, we've improved that situation so that the numbers of deaf people in hospital and GP's appointments have having access to an interpreter has really improved. As a result of that, the cost to the NHS of providing that service has gone up. Now, we've recently reached a situation where this interpreting contract is due to be renewed, but it's been postponed because the value of the contract has gone into another bracket and requires a lot more work. Now, my obvious first concern is with the cutbacks, what's going to happen to that? But on the other hand, we feel that there could be efficiencies made with the interpreting service. They could work a lot better than they are at the moment. And I feel that that is another way where maybe small savings could be made. And if those small savings were made elsewhere throughout the NHS, then possibly that could be a way of trying to save some money.
Okay. So it's like you're saying that in the services you use, you can see for your members efficiencies that could be made without compromising service?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
So would you be looking for greater engagement from the board and NHS Tayside in having those discussions with you?
Yes, I think that's happening to an extent at the moment. There are quarterly meetings, and people from the NHS come to the Deaf Hub, which is where deaf people meet in Dundee, and they have discussions with us, and they ask us questions, and we give the answers. Some things take a long time to happen, but I think that's the case with any large organisation. Mm-hmm. But I think they are genuinely listening at the moment.
That level of engagement four times a year sounds good.
Yeah. Okay.
Sonia Cotton from the Pain Association.
I'd just like to echo what Brian said there, as well as other people around the table here. And I think when we talk about sort of cost savings, and we look at that down the line, it's not just about the withdrawal of services and the reduction of them. It's about looking at how we change how we work. And the way to do that, and particularly with the integration of health and social care, is, you know, to really embrace the partnership working. Pain Association do have a service level agreement with NHS Tayside to provide services for chronic pain patients. We are currently operating under a 3-year service level agreement. Obviously, after that, it will need to be revised. And of course, when it comes to revising that in 2018, we recognise that we'll be dealing with different people due to the integration. The problem with that is the new personalities that we don't yet know about, who we are going to have to deal with. You know, we need to be making those inroads. We need to be speaking about services. We need to be sat around the table saying, what is it that service users need? And we're only going to be able to do that if we're invited to sit round that table and have those discussions, rather than somebody on the outset, like ourselves, coming in and saying, well, this is what we can do, here's the evaluation, here's the outcomes and the values, now you make a decision. That there has to be that discussion. And a couple of years ago, when the Scottish Government were providing funding to every health board to improve chronic pain services, the disappointment for us was NHS Tayside were the only board that we weren't involved in the discussions with, you know, as sort of service user representation, which was a bit of a disappointment, you know, considering all the other discussions that we've had. But certainly we do need more of that discussion around the table to move on.
So you don't have the same level of interaction and engagement with NHS Tayside in terms of listening to your members as, say, Deaflinks do?
No.
Okay.
No. We have a good relationship in terms of, you know, we'll provide sort of all the reporting material, but that's where it stops. It's not a two-way conversation, and that needs to happen, because there's lots of, you know, opportunities out there whereby we were set up on the Sky Gateway referral platform to help GPs to be able to refer direct to our services. So, again, it keeps patients potentially out of this revolving door syndrome of representing. Avoiding potential unnecessary referrals to secondary care, but we've not yet had any GPs from Tayside utilise that.
And Sonia, what is the level of clinical care like for your members?
All the feedback that we've had, I have to say, from the members that use our groups, that they've been sort of completely satisfied. They do feel that they've had, you know, been in the right place at the right time. And there's never been sort of any issues about the length of waits, etc. But the number of people that are coming to us saying, I just wish we'd heard about you, because we've not been, you know, for all the times that we've been in the system, whether it be sort of within the chronic pain service or within the GP, I just wish we'd heard about you, because it's not been mentioned. So
it's an issue of clinicians and the NHS signposting patients to you so you can come together as
yes.
a group.
Yes.
I've heard similar from Maggie Centre and other organisations as well.
Yes. And in the meantime, you know, the patients are being denied that service that can help them.
Okay. Is there anything else you'd like to add? Okay. Can I move on briefly to the third theme, which is what should NHS Tayside's health services look like in the future? What services do you think we will need? And are there any we won't need? If witnesses would like to add anything finally to kind of future services, please feel free to do so. If you feel you've said what you want to say, that's fine as well. But if you can indicate to me if you'd like to speak, that would be great. Maureen.
I would like to see the health service move forward and agree with Sonia. I think that the voluntary sector is underused, and we're always used to thinking creatively with very little money. We have to do that. We've always done that historically. And I just think the way that the carer reference group in the improvement plan in NHS Tayside works in the acute sector, I think that could work in the integrated boards. Mm-hmm. And I would like to see it in the integrated boards. I would like to see it support co-production, working in partnership with family carers as equal partners in care, because family carers of people with profound disabilities, in fact family carers in general, are used to living on very little money. They have to be creative. So you have people out there who use the services, and the carer reference group within the improvement plan in NHS Tayside is effective. It's very effective, it's very open, it's very honest. And likewise, NHS Tayside are very open and honest back. So I would like to see that model replicated for people with profound disabilities in the primary care sector as well, not just the acute.
And in integrated joint boards?
Yes.
Okay. Mary Ballantyne.
In terms of chronic care and self-management, which is the great discussion in, you know, in the health arena at the moment, Angus Cardiac Group would like to work closely in partnership with our health board, not just the immediate health board, but with others, to try and shape how we move forward. We need to be part of the discussions proactively. A little bit of what Sonia was saying resonates with us. You need to be in it from the beginning rather than trying to deal with the fait accompli. And that's something that I think we can continue to contribute. A little bit around the savings too. We do a lot of fundraising. We try to provide a lot of equipment back into the NHS. And we're quite happy to continue to do that, to try and support our partners as how we see them. But equally, we need to see a little bit of that reciprocated. If we're working hard to try and put something into the NHS in terms of equipment and support, we would like to think that we can also impact on some of the ancillary staff who we depend on so much for making appointments, portering us around. You know, the nurses and the doctors have to deal with us when we're sick. So we know that we need to be respectful to them. But sitting here today listening to some of the challenges that they're facing, it seems to me no wonder that there's some friction at the coalface when the sick person is trying to liaise with the caregivers and the ancillary team who are trying to support them. So moving forward, if we could be involved in anything that would support that or improve that moving forward, we would love to be. We've been involved in nurse training and doctors training and so on as in terms of trying to work in partnership. But I'm just wondering if we need to be engaged with others, the more support, other support staff in the NHS, that we could perhaps help or do something that would improve that situation for them. We're very good at self-managing our conditions. Maybe we can help with a little bit of the hearts and minds of the ancillary and the other support teams in terms of it is worth your while to go the extra mile. So maybe we could do something there.
Thank you. I think that's very useful, certainly to get on the record as well, all that advice. Raymond Marshall, Unison.
Yeah, I just want to touch on the future of services, and I think that the integration agenda is important in that. And
absolutely.
I think that the trade unions are involved in the upper Tayside, the three IJBs that sit across. They said, I think the part of some of the concerns for us is around the joint up and the concern that because there is different the three different IJBs that. Our service is going to be delivered differently in different areas. And that is because of the approaches by the three different IJBs seem to be different and how they're taking it forward. And I think that the health part has to be strong in that to ensure that it is delivered the same. But at the moment, the way that it's been structured and set up is different across Tayside. So that's a concern, I think, that... Is that going to impact on how the services through health are delivered as well? So, I mean, fully support that the delivery of care as close to a patient's home as possible. But is that going to be the same? And I think it's a good direction to go, and I think staff are very supportive of it in particular areas. But my concern is it joined up across the three areas within Tayside, and are we going to be delivered different services across Tayside?
Do you mean standards of service being the same? Because it's my understanding that integrated joint boards are set up to balance local accountability, and they're being done slightly differently in different areas, so the three areas in Tayside. But are you concerned about the standard of service?
I would hate to say the standard, because I think, from my members' point of view, they are delivering a good standard of care. It's how it's delivered. I think there'd be a concern if you may get one service in a different way in one area than they do in another.
Okay.
But I think health has to be stronger in that to ensure, because they are the common, health is the common denominator across the three IJBs.
Yeah.
And we need to be sure that we're ensuring that's happening for the population of Tayside.
Thank you. Bob McGlashan, RCN.
Yeah, very quickly, obviously I think it was touched on by yourself, predominantly a lot of services and expectations of service users is that there will be doctors, there will be medical staff that will be leading on some of these services. And I think to move forward, we've got to look at enhancements of nursing services, enhancements of their AHP colleagues as well, that maybe a nurse AHP-led services that will fill some of the gaps and provide, so I would believe, the same level of service to the patients, but again, would have an impact on the costs for NHS Tayside as well.
Great. Thank you. Would anyone else like to say, add? Yes.
Initial contribution, because from what we're hearing is there appears to be a general degree of satisfaction with the level of health provision by Tayside, and the issue seems to be about resource management within the NHS Tayside. And clearly we know from the figures about the increased use of agency, and that's been a major contributing factor to the deficit accumulation over recent years. We know the problem. You outlined the problem very articulately, Bob. What is the solution? I mean, my understanding as a former health secretary is that the cost of agency nursing, and I make a distinction between agency nursing and bank. Nursing, because they are two different things, but the agency takes about 180% of the cost of a nurse. The agency takes a fair chunk of that. Obviously, the nurse gets a bit more than he or she would get in NHS Tayside. I set up an initiative that doesn't seem to have gone anywhere, as is usual sometimes in the health service, making things happen, where the agency function would be brought inside the National Health Service and any profit would be recycled inside the National Health Service. I think it's ridiculous that these private profiteers are profiting from the stresses and strains that we're facing in health. And it's easy money, to say the least. So what is the RCN solution to the problem? Somebody once said that Mrs. Thatcher...
Alex, sorry, can you sit nearer your microphone?
Yeah,
please?
Sure. Somebody once said that Mrs. Thatcher liked people to bring not just the problem, but the solution. So what's the solution, Bob?
I don't have the definitive solution.
Big question, Bob.
Yeah, I know, and I certainly can't nurses, because if I did, I wouldn't be sitting here, because I would be just in somewhere nice and sunny, spending my money. No, there isn't one solution, but I think we've got to look at this, if we can just chip away at the problem. And I think one of the big issues that we've had, and I've certainly had discussions with Les McLean, the Chief Executive, just recently about how do we move forward about sort of narrowing that gap, particularly about a question that was asked before, people leaving, going to the agency, as opposed to maybe wanting to come and take a shorter-term contract or shorter-hour contract.
Would you agree about bringing the agency function inside to the National Health Service and not using these companies? Profit-making companies.
I can't comment on that. I think what we have
got
is we've
got...
If we've got a workforce within NHS Tayside who have serviced NHS Tayside and delivered care to patients for a number of years, there's a huge experience there. Invaluable experience that's built over a long period of time. If these people are then going and working elsewhere, if they're working for an agency, they don't necessarily have to come and work for NHS Tayside. They could be working anywhere in Scotland.
No, but I mean, the vast bulk of the work these agencies get is from NHS Scotland. They're making vast profits from NHS Scotland and contributing to the problem. Mm-hmm. And there's no added value because NHS Scotland could manage that agency just as well, if not better. And if we were managing our own resource, surely that would be far better for everybody. It would be part of the answer, would it not?
I think part of the answer is to look after the staff that we've got that are coming up to retirement, look into the reasons as to why staff are leaving, you know, not just for retirement, staff are leaving the NHS or NHS Tayside, try and address what these issues are, increase things like morale, look at incentives for people to come back into NHS Tayside, for example, flexible working. You know, I know it's not just unique to Tayside, but with constraints with recruitment, with the vacancies, with the lack of nurses, for example, that are out there, everybody's vying for the same pool of graduates every year. So we need to.
We're not bringing in enough trainees to begin
with. No, we're not. I was just coming to that. We're not bringing enough trainees through. Okay. And that was about a workforce plan that was done probably about 10 years ago plus. That the determination was we would need less nurses. However, I think that's been proven over the past 2 to 3 years, those figures were inaccurate because it didn't take into cognizance the amount of people that were retiring and the age profile.
Or the complexity of the patients.
But I think, you know, there's ways we need to look to see, right, how do we retain the people we've got? How do we make the people within NHS Tayside, the staff, feel valued? Because there are a number of people who are leaving in the last 2 to 3 years within the NHS. They're coming to us for advice, not to take anything formal, but for advice, say, I don't feel my last 2 or 3 years were valued within my employer. Now, something's changed within that, and I don't think there's, I can't pinpoint exactly what's changed. That's how people are feeling. So therefore, when at 55, still very young, they can take their pension, then they're looking to go to another employer, for example, the agency, to continue to deliver care. And it's about redressing that. And I think if we spend, there's, as I say, don't have one size fits all, but it's about valuing the staff we've got, making those staff feel valued right up to the end of their career, and hopefully then there will be some benefits for NHS Tayside, but actually for the patient groups within NHS Tayside, we will retain that experience in some shape or form. At the moment, that doesn't appear to be happening.
Thank you.
For the record, Alex, I agree with your suggestion. I think we've created a market in nursing where there's actually no need to be one. Can I thank witnesses very much indeed for your time this morning? I know that giving evidence to a committee on such an important topic can be daunting, but your contributions have been extremely valuable, both for us as members and I'm sure for the public gallery. We'll put this report into its proper context for us as well. I'm now going to suspend the committee for 5 minutes to allow a changeover of witnesses. Thank you. We now move to our next evidence session on NHS Tayside. Can I encourage members and witnesses to keep their contributions as short and concise as possible so we can get through all the issues, and I will intervene if necessary to move things along. I'd like to welcome to the meeting this morning Leslie McLay, Chief Executive, Professor John Connell, Chair of the Board, Lindsay Bedford, Director of Finance, and Tony Gaskin, Chief Internal Auditor, all of NHS Tayside. I also welcome Lindsay Patterson and Gillian Collin, both of PricewaterhouseCoopers, who are appointed by Audit Scotland to act as the external auditors for NHS Tayside. I invite Professor Connell, Chair of the Board, to make a brief opening statement before I open up to questions from members.
Thank you, Convener. And if I could thank the committee for the opportunity to make this short statement now, and I appreciate there are a number of issues that the committee will wish to explore that arise from the Section 22 report from the Auditor General, and I can assure you that I and my colleagues want to answer these questions that you have in a transparent and constructive manner. For the record, I became Chair of NHS Tayside a little over 1 year ago, so midway through the period of the Section 22 report. And as a clinician with around 40 years of experience in the NHS, I would like to assure the committee at the start of my personal commitment to make sure that the Board will sustain high quality, safe and effective health services for our patients, their families and our communities across the region. That is vital. In the last 18 months, a major review has been undertaken to understand why Tayside NHS Board is in its current financial position, and this has allowed us to develop plans to address this in a manner described in our transformation programme. Time is limited, and rather than spend too much on that, I will keep this statement short and allow the committee the opportunity to explore the issues that it has. But I should state that in developing our understanding of the current position and in building our plans, which I think are credible for financial stability, we have worked very closely with the Scottish Government, and I would like to acknowledge that support that we've had. We've also worked very closely with health and social care partnerships, local authority colleagues and third sector organisations to build a sustainable and affordable set of services for our community. Vitally, we are developing our plans in partnership and are fully committed to partnership working with staff organisations. I think the Board should acknowledge that prior to our partnership review, which was jointly commissioned by our Director of HR and by our Employee Director, there were difficulties experienced in partnership working and relations with trade unions. That is now improving. Work has progressed over the last 18 months, and I can say that with some confidence as I do attend all of our Area Partnership Forum meetings. These are co-chaired by our Employee Director and by our Chief Executive. That positive work has been recognised by the Minister of Mental Health, who attended our annual review earlier this year, who commented on the improved partnership working that was noted. And as recently as last week, we had a formal assurance to our Staff Governance Committee that there was engagement and positive development of partnership working. But I'm happy, as are my colleagues, to address questions that you might have in that regard. And finally, we have a very close relationship with the University of Dundee in an academic health sciences partnership, which allows us to address issues of training and retention and recruitment of clinical staff, particularly nursing staff, AHP and medical staff, and offers clear opportunities for all of our staff to drive innovation into health service delivery. So in summary, Chair, Committee, we would acknowledge that running a deficit is not acceptable and must be addressed. You have my personal commitment as Chairman that the Board has an unremitting focus on return to financial stability. Our five-year transformation programme is actively addressing our financial position in a credible and structured way, and it is led by our clinicians and is being developed in partnership with our trade unions. I think we have good evidence that this approach is already working. We have traction with improved financial metrics, again, which we are happy to demonstrate to you. And finally, safe, high quality and effective clinical care and treatment built on positive staff experience is what we have always delivered to the people of Tayside, and that will not change. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Connell. I'm going to invite Gail Ross to open questioning.
Thank you, Professor Connell, for your opening statement. It was very helpful. As you said, we had evidence from the Auditor General to this committee on the 3rd of November, and I refer back to the evidence session and the official report on particular page 29, and you did touch on it in your opening statement. And the Auditor General said that NHS Tayside is in discussion with the Scottish Government about its financial position. Can you update us on these discussions, please?
Yes, I'll start off giving you brief context and then pass over to Chief Executive Leslie McClay. But we have regular meetings and discussions with the Scottish Government, particularly with the Finance Director, Christine McLaughlin, and John Connachan, Director of Performance. And as recently as yesterday, Leslie McClay, Lindsay Bedford and I had meetings with those two people to discuss our financial plans for the future. In doing that, we have presented to them our plans for the current financial year, which they have approved, and our plans for the next 5 years, which include, over that period of time, full repayment of any outstanding brokerage over a five-year period. And they have agreed that this is a credible plan which they are happy to support. But I will pass over to my colleague, Leslie McClay, to give further information on that.
Thank you, Chairman. Just to further add to that, the part of the detailed conversation we've been having with Scottish Government is in relation to getting the Board back into financial balance. This year in particular, the view was that we needed to work hard around our building our five-year plan and therefore the discussions in terms of the actual payback are going to commence from 2017-18 beyond. But we are confident with the work that we've done to date that within the 5 year, this being year one of our 5 year plan, that we will be back in financial balance at the end of year five.
Okay, thank you for that. Just to follow on from that, Convener, if I may, also from the last evidence session, the Auditor General said in her report that the repayment plan was part of the conditions for brokerage, but in this case it appears that a payment plan was not realistic. Why did that ever come to pass? If now you have a payment plan in place, why was the first one not realistic?
I think there were a number of factors. The work that we've been doing in particular over the last 18 months has allowed us to have a deep analysis around the service models that we deliver to the population of Tayside. We have a model where we have a high inpatient facilities. We have 26 hospital sites, and in fact we actually deliver care from over 440 locations. In terms of the models of care, we've also had a historical focus around inpatient models. So as much as we've been and are continuing to develop our community and our primary care new service models, and I think we heard some of those earlier this morning, we've still been retaining a high number of inpatient beds, some of which are very small units and also low occupancy. So I think our work in the last 18 months in particular has given us a far greater understanding of why the cost pressures are being experienced by the board. And therefore, the view was that this wasn't something that we, in order to make the change, we want the change to be done with our clinicians leading it. We want our public involved and engaged. And I think we fully recognise this wasn't something we were going to turn around within the first 12 months. So 5 years may feel like a long time, and I fully understand that point of view, but it's really important we get this right. It's important our clinicians lead the change with us, and it's important what we do is a sustainable change for the population of Tayside, and hence the reason that government have agreed with us that this should be done over a 5 year period.
Okay. In the report from the Auditor General, which was October, it said the board is projecting a potential deficit of 11.65 million for 2016-17. But in your minute of the board meeting of the 1st of December in the financial report, it said that this could be 18 to 20 million pound shortfall at the end of the year. And despite best efforts, things were still not improving. There was an ongoing overspend month on month, and there had to be an acceleration to make the necessary savings. And the board went on then to note the current position and support the actions being taken to contain spend. This would seem to me that we have gone in 2 months from a serious position to what would seem to be a very serious position. Are these actions being accelerated as it was recommended in the financial report? And is this a final estimation for the year end, or is there a possibility that things might get even worse?
Okay.
I'll perhaps start that and then pass over to my two colleagues, but I think you're right to say the board always wishes to give very careful scrutiny to financial projections. The board is aware of the need to hit a target of 11.67 million by the end of this financial year, and is aware of a need to have an accelerated programme to deliver that. That programme is in place, and if you would like further detail, I can pass that over to Lindsay Bedford, our financial director. But we are confident, having met Scottish Government yesterday, that our planning assumptions should see us hit that target by the end of the financial year. But Mr Bedford may wish to give you detail of our accelerated plans.
Thank you. So at the board meeting at the end of October, we took to the board a range of a forecast outturn and also a further actions paper. The further actions centred around the benefit that the board is going to receive from employing in excess of 200 newly qualified practitioners, which will alleviate the level of non-contract agency spend that the board's been incurring in the first half of the year. That will have a significant impact in the remaining months of the year. And also, also touched on within the Auditor General's report is the position on prescribing. So we have a further range of actions, an accelerated programme that will deliver a benefit in this year, but more importantly will deliver a significant recurring benefit going into 2017-18.
Okay, thank you.
Colin Beattie.
Thank you, Convener. My first question is really for the external auditors. On the 2nd of December 2015, Pricewaterhouse gave evidence that a substantial portion of the deficit was comprised of pension fund deficits and increased national insurance costs. I can understand the national insurance costs, but I've not seen this reference to pension fund deficits having to be funded by the board. It's not referenced in any of the other documents I've got here. It's not referenced by Audit Scotland specifically as a cause of the deficit. It's not in your own management reports. Can you tell me, firstly, was that evidence that was given correct? And secondly, how do you account for pension fund deficits?
In terms of the evidence given around pension fund deficits, I'm afraid I don't have that information to hand. So I'm afraid I can't answer that question.
Can the internal auditor answer that question?
The only thing I can think of, and this would be speculation, is that the level of...
But we're not here to speculate. This is a pretty basic thing. I mean, we're talking about millions of pounds of deficit. I want to know how it's accounted for.
I didn't make that statement, so I don't know why it was made.
Can they perhaps come back to the committee with a...
I think Finance Director Lindsay Bedford wants to come in.
Yes, I can. So it doesn't reflect the pension fund deficit. It reflects the increase in superannuation employers' contribution that all boards had to increase their contributions by in the year 2014-15. So it's across Scotland, all boards.
But the evidence that was given on the 2nd of December clearly separated out increased national insurance costs pension fund deficits as a result of the revaluation of the pension. So either that evidence was correct or not, how are you accounting for pension fund deficits?
Lindsay Bedford.
The boards do account for any change through the increase in the employers' contributions. The superannuation rate increased in 2014-15, and the national insurance increase came through in 2015-16.
So we're talking about something totally different here. I understand about the national insurance contributions. I understand about the increase in them. What I'm trying to get to the bottom of is, was the evidence given by Price Waterhouse on the 2nd of December correct? Mm-hmm.
If I can perhaps add, my understanding would be that health boards do not directly fund pension funds. They are part of the SPPA, and therefore the pension fund is the costs are met by superannuation contributions, which, as our finance director pointed out, rose. And that's not the same thing as having a pension deficit, and I suspect it may be a misstatement by PwC.
Lindsay Patterson.
Yes, it would have been my colleague that gave that evidence, and certainly as
far as... It was Kenny Wilson.
Yes, and certainly as far as pension fund deficits, quite rightly, they are not on the balance sheet of an NHS organisation. I would need to clarify that evidence that my colleague gave and come back to you, so
I'd appreciate
for
it if
that.
You could on that.
If you could write to the committee, Ms Patterson, with that information, that would be very helpful. Colin Beattie.
The other thing is, looking at all the evidence that we've seen on this, As an audit committee, we look, obviously, historically, we look backwards. Is there not every evidence over a period of years of management incompetence and fiscal irresponsibility as far as NHS Tayside is concerned? We're sitting in a situation that over the next 5 years, you've got to find the better part of £200 million. That doesn't seem like good planning from years back.
Again, if I can start that off and then pass probably to Leslie McClay. I think firstly, Mr. Beattie has pointed out that this situation did not arise overnight. It has arisen as a result of, I think, a substantial number of years of operational models that did not recognise the true financial situation that NHS Tayside was in. As our Chief Executive pointed out, the model operated in Tayside has been one that has been over-reliant on inpatient beds, running an excessive number of sites over what was necessary to deliver health care for the population needs in the 21st century. And the Health Board, in earlier years, perhaps running up to 2012, balanced its books on the back of asset sales and other manoeuvres, so that it appeared to be in financial balance when, in fact, it was living, I believe, out with its means. That has now been recognised, so I believe that there is competence in terms of having transparency over the accounting, understanding the reasons why there has been an unsustainable position, and putting in place credible plans to address it.
But Professor Connell, you say that has now been recognised. How long have you been in this job?
I've been in the chair since October 2015.
Okay, and Leslie McClay, how long have you worked for NHS Tayside?
5.5 years.
Okay, as Chief Operating Officer.
I was 2.5 years as Chief Operating Officer, and then I was appointed in December 13 as Chief Executive.
And Lindsay Bedford, how long have you been with NHS Tayside?
I've been with Tayside 33 years.
So well aware of issues in the past. Colin Beattie.
Can I just refer to NHS Tayside's annual report, Pricewaterhouse, which was actually dated June 2016, although it's the year to 31st March, where it actually questions the sustainability and uncertainty about the financial situations. Now, that's only weeks ago. And now you're sitting in front of us saying everything's going to be fine, you're going to find £200 million over the next 5 years. You know, it's hard to see that evidence. And I've seen your financial, all the stuff you've sent us on financial sustainability, your five-year plan. It's not that strong, is it?
I would argue that it has been developed in conjunction with the Scottish Government. It has evolved over the last year, and I believe that it is robust and credible. I would put it to you that in this financial year, we are looking to achieve savings of £46.7 million, and I believe we'll deliver that. That, in terms of NHS Tayside, is an unprecedented saving to achieve. And the balance of savings between recurrent and non-recurrent savings is moving in the direction which I think is appropriate towards recurrent savings. So I believe our future plans are credible.
Given the level of savings that you have to achieve, what impact do you anticipate on the patient's experience?
You'll recall that I gave a commitment in my opening statement that NHS Tayside is entirely committed to sustaining safe and secure services for patients across our region. I do not anticipate there being impact on the current level of services. Our service performance has not been affected thus far by our financial position.
Liam Kerr.
Thank you. Just before asking substantive questions, I just want to pick on a very quick point that was made there. There was a task force about 15 years ago, I understand, which produced a series of recommendations how to avoid getting into this situation. It sounds as though rather a lot of the senior management team were part of the team tasked with not getting us into this situation. Is that correct?
I'm afraid 15 years ago is somewhat before my time in Tayside. At that stage, I was working in Glasgow, and I think our chief executive also was not in Tayside at that stage.
But Mr. Bedford was.
Mr. Bedford would be a junior member of the finance team at that time.
But is there a question mark, Mr. Professor Connell, around the people or this situation that has resulted? It would rather appear that the senior management team have been in post and presided over it. Is that fair?
I think it's fair to say that the model that was operated in Tayside was appropriate for the time in question. Tayside at the stage was operating on a different allocation of central funding through the NRAC formula. It was spending money, I believe, appropriately on the type of care that was appropriate. What it did not do was recognise the change in circumstance with the change towards a form of care that was more based on the community and less on inpatient sites. That is something that has happened since 2012, and also did not come to terms with the fact that it had, relatively speaking, had a fall in its NRAC financial allocation. Those were two factors that I believe were not foreseen.
So I have three questions which I'll just fire to keep them very brief. So first of all, there are expected to be efficiencies in areas including drugs and prescribing. The prescription costs I understand to be the third highest in the country. So my questions are, why are prescription costs so high within NHS Tayside? Why was this initiative only started at the beginning of October? Why is it taking so long to start? And how are those efficiencies going to be achieved in drugs and prescribing? And what impact does that have on service delivery?
Okay, again, I will start and pass to Lindsay, Leslie McClay for full detail, but I would rebut the allegation that the initiative's only started in October. NHS Tayside has had an active medicines management programme going back ever since I've been chair. The specific initiatives that are focusing on some aspects of prescribing have begun in October. We have been actively managing medicines management ever since I've been chair and before that time. In terms of why are our costs high in comparison to the rest of Scotland, that's a complex argument. It conceals a number of factors, including the fact that in some areas, Tayside is, I think, better at identifying patients with complex chronic illnesses who require prescriptions. I'll give you one example of that. We treat more patients with the condition atrial fibrillation in Tayside than any other health board in Scotland per head of population, due to very good general practice performance. That incurs a cost. The benefit of that is that we see a much lower rate of stroke in Tayside than we do in the rest of Scotland. So we can balance a prescribing cost that we incur now with a long-term benefit in terms of stroke incidence. That, I would put, is something that patients actually appreciate, is not having the risk of stroke. So it's a direct patient benefit.
But if you undertake efficiencies, you're going to stop delivering on that, aren't you?
No. What we will do is focus on areas where we have evidence of waste and variation so we can sustain the high-performing areas of prescribing and focus on the areas that we believe are amenable to cost constraint, and I'll pass that to my Chief Executive.
Thank you. So there are a number of areas we've looked at where we believe that there are changes we can make, supported obviously by our clinical colleagues. In particular, we have, for example, a pathway where we have a typical type of pain-relieving drug that has been identified and is being used quite excessively in terms of high volumes of that drug. And there are, through work with our primary care practitioners, there are alternatives to that type of drug. So pregabalin is one of them, which is a pain-relieving drug. And there is a high usage of that in Tayside, and it's a very costly drug. So some of the work we've been doing in particular is working with both our secondary and primary care physicians, because it's important they work together, and identifying in terms of formulae what would be other drugs that could be used that would have the same quality impact in terms of the patient, but actually are not as expensive. And those conversations have been going on for a number of months, in particular in this year, and we're now actively promoting the changes in those pathways.
So when will they conclude, and how much will be saved?
Well, we have a detailed plan of initiatives that we will have in place by the end of March, that over the next 4 months.
Turning to agency staff, reliance on agency staff is up by 39% in the last year. Why has NHS Tayside got such a high reliance on agency staff?
Okay.
Why hasn't anything been done before? And how long before it gets sorted out?
Okay, so I, first of all, I can update the committee that NHS Tayside has a 30% reduction today in terms of the number of non-contract agency nurses it was using at this time last year. So there has been significant work in the board. I think we heard from our colleagues earlier this morning around concerns, and certainly from our perspective, it's absolutely a key objective of the board is to reduce either down to zero or down with a very risk-assessed plan in terms of when you would actually use a non-contract nurse. We have been doing a huge amount of work around our recruitment, and I think my colleague earlier said that we were really successful this year, and we've recruited over 200 newly qualified nurse practitioners, and they are now all fully within the system. We are going to continue to look at how we reduce that spend. We have invested in an e-rostering solution. So we did that 2 years ago, and we've been working in partnership with our colleagues, trade union colleagues, with our clinicians, and we're now in the process of fully rolling out that e-rostering solution. By the end of December, that will be fully rolled out across all of Ninewell's wards and PRI. It's already in Ninewell's, and we're in the closing stages within PRI Hospital. Implementing that solution has allowed us to give much more detailed analysis on how we're deploying our nurses, and there is undoubtedly areas where we can be much more efficient around the deployment. So examples of that would be around annual leave, around time out management. It's really important, we heard earlier, it's so important to us that staff get their time off, but it's actually about how they plan to do that throughout the year. So the work we've done around e-rostering is giving us far more detail. It allows us to be able to take that helicopter view. We've also introduced this year, 4 times a day we have huddles where all our nursing staff and other support colleagues come together at 4 times, both in Ninewell's and PRI, looking at what are the staffing levels in the ward, are there, in terms of the acuity of the patient, do we need to up those levels? And I also can advise the committee that NHS Tayside fully implements the National Nursing Workforce Tools, and that clearly has increased the level of nursing resource that we are placing in our ward.
Thank you. My final area of interest, I'm led to believe that there is a performance-related extra payment that senior management can get. Are you able to comment on that? If there is some kind of performance-related pay, against what benchmark is that measured, and what performance is being rewarded?
Okay.
Well, again, I should perhaps start with that and then pass over to my colleague to give you final detail. But senior management staff within the NHS are paid outside the agenda for change arrangements and are paid in a different centrally managed, ministerially directed pay scale. All of these staff are subject to evaluation on an annual basis, and any approval of performance-related pay, which is what you're describing, is given by the National Performance Management Committee. Annually, all staff are appraised against a whole series of objectives, which include delivery of clinical services, management of resource, management of staff working under their direction, and management of our contribution to the objectives of NHS Tayside. Based on that performance, they will be awarded an uplift in their pay, which is reviewed and approved by the Ministerial Committee centrally. This is not finally approved by NHS Tayside. I can assure you that in the year in question, 66 staff received a payment, incurring a total cost to NHS Tayside of £87,000.
I think you were going to pass over
sorry.
To you.
Sorry, you covered most of that.
If you don't have anything to add, that's okay.
Yeah, unless there's anything in addition that we haven't covered, I'm more than happy to answer that.
So just to confirm then, 66 staff, this is senior management, have received extra payments over and above their salary for performance. And what are the benchmarks? Can you give me any examples of what the senior management delivered to NHS Tayside in order to receive this uplift?
Yeah. So within that group, there are different levels of grading. Within that 66, there was a high proportion of those had an acceptable, fully acceptable performance. So that would be that they delivered on their objectives. Each of the senior managers had core objectives, and then they had specific ones that were relevant to their specialty. So the core objectives clearly would include deliverables around clinical care, around clearly financial governance, workforce, and then in particular there would be specific ones. So within this cohort you will have e-health colleagues, you will have HR colleagues, and then there will be agreed objectives in their particular area that then would be added to make a total of 8 objectives. And in terms of the decision around where they land, there is a scoring mechanism that is graded for every single objective, and therefore there's an accumulative score that would then determine whether that individual would land in a fully acceptable or not acceptable or superior or outstanding
in terms of performance. Did you and Mr. Bedford receive a performance-related uplift?
In the 2015-16 year, I was given a fully acceptable performance.
Right. And just a quick question to the external auditors. What's your view on the performance-related payments, if any?
From our perspective, in terms of the performance-related payments, they followed due process in terms of how they were determined, but we don't audit the actual awarding of those pay performance ratings themselves.
Mr. Bedford, did you receive a performance-related uplift?
I did, and same as the Chief Executive, I was awarded fully accepted.
Thank you.
Colin Beattie.
Thank you. It seems to me that we're rewarding people for doing their jobs. I mean, fully acceptable to me means that you've done your job. It doesn't mean to say you've done something additional that necessarily merits any sort of a bonus or additional payment. And especially at the moment when we're looking at a situation where, and I'll say it again, we seem to be in a situation where there's been clear evidence of management incompetence over a long period, and fiscal responsibility, we're rewarding people for doing their jobs. Doesn't that send an odd message?
Let's pick that up. Firstly, I would remind Mr. Beattie that the performance is not entirely based on financial metrics, but in many staff it's in terms of managing issues such as e-health, HR, clinical delivery, etc. And therefore I think it's very reasonable to assess staff across a range of metrics.
But is it not sending the wrong message while NHS Tayside is in the present situation?
Well, you may comment that, but we are using a system that is used across all health boards. Staff in senior management positions are not part of Agenda for Change. and all health boards are obliged to assess senior managers using this system, which, if their performance is deemed acceptable, and I believe that there is a robust system for assessment of that, there is an automatic payment made which is approved at ministerial level.
But given all the overruns on costs here, people have got more money available to achieve these targets and to reach acceptability. Surely, if you were comparing like for like across the NHS, you'd be looking at other health boards that were in a tight financial situation, that were managing it, and that were still delivering the care.
Okay. There are annual data produced which compare staff performance across all health boards. Now, I can't look at other health boards by name because they're given a, if you like, an anonymised number. But what I can tell you is that the evaluation of staff in Tayside is not in any way above average, and indeed is probably slightly below the national average for assessment of staff managerial performance over the year in question. So I believe there has been a recognition that staff have delivered an acceptable performance, but that there are challenges in what they have to achieve.
I still find it difficult to get my head around people getting a bonus for acceptable performance, and certainly that would not happen in the private sector. To get a bonus, you have to actually achieve something, exceed your targets, exceed what you're expected to do in order to qualify. Thank you.
Alex Neil.
Thank you, Convener. Can I go back to the figures on the deficit and the so-called brokerage, which is really a debt to the Scottish Government? First of all, can I just clarify, am I right in saying that your estimated savings for the current financial year, 16-17, is just over £46 million? Is that right?
That's correct.
And am I right in saying you're also projecting at the moment a deficit for this year of just over £11.6 million.
Yes.
Is that right?
Yes.
Now, in the Auditor General's report earlier this year, still dealing with the current financial year, first of all, it said the projection was total savings as a percentage of baseline resource funding was 8.4%. So does that £46 million still represent 8.64%? So what's the percentage now?
The 46.7 is 6.7%.
So the savings have gone down by about 25% since the Auditor General's report.
No, so when NHS Tayside was putting its financial plan in place for 2016-17, in order to break even, so financially balance the books, the board was looking to save, or required to save, in the region of £58 million, which you're correct in terms of that being 8.7%. At that time, there was planning that was happening across all the boards in Scotland, which was providing an opportunity for sums of money from national initiatives to be included within the board's financial plan. And we built that in. So at that point, we were building in our own work that we believed we could successfully deliver in year, which was coming in at £46 million. And then there was additional sum on top of that that we would draw down from our contribution to deliver of national initiatives, which one would be like sort of shared services. However, as we were working nationally and regionally, we recognised the risk in relation to the delivery of the national initiatives just due to the timeline that some of them would take to deliver. And therefore, it was a board decision right at the beginning of this financial year that our ability to deliver 58 on our own, we believed we would put ourselves completely at risk. And clearly, the quality and our clinical care that we provide is paramount to us. And therefore, right from the beginning, I submitted a local delivery plan with a financial target of 46.7. We believed that was a target that was, it would be a stretch target for the board, given previous years in terms of what we delivered, but the work that we'd done, we believed that we could deliver on that. And therefore, right from the beginning with Scottish Government, they were clear and they signed off our local delivery plan that said we would deliver the 46.7.
Yeah, I understand the reasons, but the Auditor General's report was published just in October. This is the early part of December. And for the reasons you explained, there's already a 25% reduction over the last 2 months in the estimated savings this year for the board, which is relevant to my questions about the next 5 years. But just before I leave this point, in the Auditor General's report of the £58 million of savings, which you estimated earlier, which is now down to 46, even then, the Auditor General said that 60% of those savings were non-recurring. 10.2% of the savings were unidentified and 12.1% were high risk. So if you combine those, 84%, nearly 85% were either non-recurring, unidentified or high risk. So based on the £46 million, what percentage now is non-recurring? What percentage now is unidentified? And which percentage is still high risk?
Okay.
Perhaps pass that to our Finance Director, Lindsay Bedford. But if I can maybe just clarify again, I think I said in response to an earlier question, the Board had recognised that in previous years it's had inappropriate reliance on non-recurring savings, and that in this financial year we are seeing a better metric in terms of that, and in future years we anticipate shifting the balance of savings so that in the final years of our five-year programme our non-recurring savings will be a much smaller proportion of our total savings.
But I'll pass just to put this in perspective, Chair, your non-recurring is 60%, yeah, maybe revised on the 46 million figure, which is the new one. That compares to an average of all the boards of half that, 30%. Yes. Your unidentified is slightly lower, and your high risk is slightly lower. But your non-recurring, and given that this is a five-year plan, there have to be surely recurring savings. You quite rightly said that previously NHS Tayside over-relied on asset sales, yep, which are literally one-offs, and it looks as though, although you've now understood the lesson, that to date you haven't actually been successful in doing anything about it.
I fully accept your point that non-recurring savings is not an appropriate way to run a business or an NHS board. And that has been recognised in this year, that is already being changed and will continue to be changed in future years. But Mr Bedford will give you the precise figures.
Thank you. So the paper again that we took to the board in October identified the progress against the existing work streams. So that identified that the board had secured £40 million of savings, of which was an equal split between recurring and non-recurring. So that was demonstrating progress already.
So 50% is still non-recurring?
50% non-recurring.
Right.
Yep. Okay. And again, the board approved the further actions that were required that would secure fully the £46.7 million, and there will be an element of that that will also be of a recurring nature. Right. So we expect to be certainly in excess of the 40% recurring that we identified within the financial framework.
So looking at the next 5 years that you say you've agreed yesterday with the senior team, senior official team in the Scottish Government, I want to explore this figure. Am I right in saying that over the next 5 years, as well as if you were breaking even, you would have still about £200 million to repay the Scottish Government? Is that right?
I hope not £200
million. What's the figure?
But our final brokerage figure will be, we believe, around £36 million. But we'd anticipate over the five-year period fully repaying that as well as achieving our savings. The total over the five-year saving of required to achieve that will be somewhere between 5% and 6%.
So the reason I think the £200 million figure came in.
Mr. Neil, can you sit closer to your microphone?
Sorry. Over the next 5 years. If you were to break even, you would need to make total savings of how much over that five-year period to break even over the 5 years?
And to repay the brokerage.
And well, I want the separate figures. How much saving would you need to make and to pay the brokerage to break even and pay back
so
your debt?
The total over the five-year period, £214 million.
So it was right. It's £214 million. Which obviously averages something like £43 million a year, or thereabouts, in savings.
Yes. Right.
And you're going to reduce the non-recurrence element of that substantially, right? So to what level are you going to reduce the non-recurrence element?
Current financial framework identifies it will move to 60% recurring and 40% non-recurring over the lifetime of the
So 60%, plan. So 40% non-recurring will still be asset sales then, basically?
No.
Or one-off
activity? Mr. Bedford can give you further examples of non-recurring.
What have you agreed yesterday? You know, can you tell us, what have you agreed yesterday for each of the 5 years? What are you going to achieve in each of those 5 years? What have you agreed with the Scottish Government?
So across the
well, each year, like next year, what savings have you to make next year?
So in 17-18, the assessment is 44 million.
And is that based on breaking even then?
That will deliver a shortfall, a small shortfall in single figures of 4 to 5 million.
4 to 5 million. So the total's 50 million basically?
To break even, yes.
You need to make savings next year of 50 million.
To break even.
What about the next year after that?
So we factored in repayments of brokerage in the following 3 years with a standard efficiency savings target of £40 million across those 3 years.
Right.
And in doing so, in delivering a £40 million efficiency saving, then as well as delivering a financial break-even, that will also repay the outstanding brokerage to the Scottish Government.
And we're expected to believe that you'll achieve that. Based on your track record, are we expected to believe you'll achieve that?
That's the discussion that we've had with
Scottish That's Government. The agreement, you said. No, that's discussion, the that's the agreement. So where are you going to make these savings? Where are you going to make £50 million of savings next year? What we agreed with the Scottish Government. Where are those savings coming from?
If I can perhaps pick this up initially and then perhaps ask Leslie Buckley to comment, but what we've achieved this year is to try to get ourselves back into financial balance or to move towards financial balance. That has given us time to look at changes in clinical service delivery, which we believe will allow us to achieve credible savings in the future. Much of that will involve moving our clinical service delivery in line with the National Clinical Strategy and the document from the Chief Medical Officer, Realistic Medicine, moving services closer to the community, less reliance on inpatient stay, reducing costly issues such as delayed discharges, which add to our bill and are not good for patients.
Professor Connell, sorry, yeah. With respect, we know what the challenges are,
yeah.
But I think Mr. Neil is asking how the 50 million savings yeah. next year specifically are going to be achieved.
Can I just say, you know, we are talking to a health board that's changed its figures dramatically on the savings. You've reduced your savings in year this year over the last 2 or 3 months. Yeah.
No, we haven't.
From 58 million to 46 million. Well, you told the Auditor General and you told me your original estimate this year was 58 million of savings. You then realised that the national savings couldn't really be relied upon and you then reduced the figure since the Auditor General's report to 46 million.
With respect, Mr. Neil, we submitted our LDP to Scottish Government at the beginning of this financial year, and that had a target of £46.7 million.
So why is the Auditor General in October saying it's still £58
million?
Because presumably the Auditor General got the figures from yourselves or from your auditors. No. Anyway, the fundamental point is this. When are we going to see the detailed plan identifying line item by line item where you're going to get £50 million of savings next year and for each of those years adding up to £214 million worth of savings over the next 5 years? And have you agreed the detail of that plan with the Scottish Government? Because I don't see how they could agree to anything until they see exactly where the savings are coming from. So where are those, over that 5 year period, have you got a list of each of the savings costed by line item to add up to £214 million?
We have a 5 year transformation programme that gives high level costings.
High level costings, what does that mean?
Well, in terms of forecasting,
it means you put your finger in the air
absolutely not.
Estimate, because that's what it looks like sitting here.
Okay. So we have a 5 year transformation plan, and every year we are building a 1 year delivery plan to give the absolute detail on how that will be delivered. So when the beginning of this year we had a very detailed plan of everything that we would deliver, costed down to the detail for 16-17. We will have exactly the same for 17-18 and 18-19 right through to 2021. So we have the 5 year overall plan with key financial figures within it. But in terms of running the organisation, taking on board any changes in terms of demand, any different ways of working, then that final detail will be published in our one-year operational plan. So we will publish for the end of March 2017 for the next 12 months, and that is the way that we've been building this plan.
Well, I would say, as somebody who was heavily involved in business planning for the last 40 years, that's a wholly inadequate approach. I mean, I realise, and one of the things that needs to be changed is this year-to-year, hand-to-mouth budgeting of the health service across Scotland, and that's not your fault, that's the fault of the system, it needs to change. But given the situation that Tayside Health Board is in, I would suggest you need not a high-level, you know, finger-in-the-air estimate. What you need is a detailed five-year business plan that shows us clearly how you're going to pay off your debt and break even without a dramatic reduction in the range of quality of services. And I don't, I mean, you just said you don't have that. You'll have it soon, hopefully, for next year.
But
50 million is a huge challenge to achieve, given that we know that rising demand, the complexity of the demand. We've just heard this morning about the challenges on nursing staffing. We've heard from yourselves. I mean, I'm told there's quite a number of consultancy vacancies and a whole range of other issues as well that need to be addressed, which impact on that. So can I suggest, and I would suggest exactly the same to the senior management in NHS Scotland, they need to answer to Parliament, because we'll be calling them as well. They need to tell us, how can they agree to something that's so thumb in the air? We need a proper plan. Item by item, where's the money going to be saved? Because quite frankly, we wouldn't believe that it's going to happen until we see that. And my own view is, I think we're going to end up with a bailout being needed by the Scottish Government to save services in Tayside. And how they fund that would need to be looked at, and they don't have the money to fund it at the moment. But quite frankly, until we see a detail, if you're running a business, you don't put your thumb in the air saying, you know, over the next 5 years, we hope that we're going to save £214 million.
Mr. Neil.
£214 million requires a detailed plan. So I think the committee should be asking Tayside, by a certain period, maybe the end of January, to give us a five-year, detailed, itemised plan on where that £214 million is going to come from.
Leslie McLeay, you did say that you'd be producing a detailed plan for the first year. When is that due to be produced? So we're working on that for 17-18. Okay, and when will it be public? When will it be ready? As I said to Mr. Neil, it'll be the end of March. Okay, and can you send it to the committee once it's ready? I'd be more than happy to do that.
And can we have an indication of the 4 years after that? Because I realise the closer in you are, next year you'll be able to give more detail than what you will be for years 2 to 5.
Yes,
but
indeed.
I do think, and I think the public in Tayside and the taxpayers
acknowledge that
need to have not just a wing and a prayer and motherhood and apple pie, we need a detailed plan.
Yeah. Thank you, Mr. Neil. Colin Beattie, can I bring you in very briefly to clarify a point?
Convener, it's really for the external auditors. In their report on NHS Tayside a few weeks ago, they stated that there is uncertainty over the financial sustainability of the board, and you also questioned the NHS Tayside as a going concern. Do you still stand by that, yes or no?
In our report, we just set out why we have to consider going concern for all of our organisations before we issue an audit opinion. And given the financial challenges which the board was facing, we set out our reason and rationale for considering
that. Your conclusion was that because it's a public concern, it will be bailed out, basically.
In effect,
it wouldn't be allowed to go down. As a going concern, yes or no, is the uncertainty over the financial instability of the board, the question over it as a going concern, as a business, do you stand by what you stated in that report a few weeks ago?
Yes, I do.
So I would interpret that as a going concern, it is not viable, and that there are questions over the financial sustainability of the board, which the board is going to have to address.
I mean, as we've set out in our report, there are clearly significant financial challenges which the board will have to address. As we've heard today, there are a number of plans in place in order to try to deliver.
I think
those.
Your point you clearly made here is that from a financial point of view, the NHSA side is simply not sustainable without very radical change.
Yes, and I think that is supported by what management has said here today.
Monica Lennon.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. In the evidence we've heard that the savings now sit around £214 million, I think is the figure that Alec Neil managed to tease out. And Professor Connell, in your opening remarks and in some of the questions today, you've sought to reassure the committee and the public today that the patient experience won't diminish, that you can manage your way through these savings. But NHS Tayside currently is only meeting 5 out of 15 national targets. So can you say if performance is currently good enough, and with the financial challenges ahead, how will that performance improve?
Thank you for that. You are right that targets that are set by government are challenging for all health boards. NHS Tayside's performance in relation to the targets in the great majority is either in the upper quartile or certainly in the middle of the pack. So I do not believe that our financial performance has impacted on our delivery of targets. If I look at the targets in detail, we are presently best in Scotland on A&E four-hour target achievement, best in Scotland over child and adolescent mental health appointments. We do have some problems around treatment time guarantees, as do all health boards.
What about cancer?
Cancer target, again, the key metric there is a 62-day for urgent referral. There we are sitting pretty well on the Scottish average at present. We have two particular cancers that do cause us concern. Urological cancers, where we have a single consultant surgeon at present who can do laparoscopic prostatectomy. We have been trying extremely hard to recruit a second urologist, but there is a national UK-wide shortage of consultant urological surgeons. Other health boards have similar problems. The solution there is for us to work with other health boards in a regional solution. Colorectal cancer is another area where, again, there have been difficulties in identifying specialists because of a national shortage. So I do not believe that's a financial issue. That is a difficulty in finding specialists who can fill roles.
I want to pick up on the RCN evidence. I think we heard from Bob McGlashan earlier today, and he spoke very well about the culture within the NHS and some of the pressures there. But looking at the written submission from the RCN are saying that they feel the culture within NHS Tayside has tended to be top-down and divisive, and this is a result of staff being under enormous pressure to find budget efficiencies. But even stronger than that, RCN are saying that management has been bullying towards members of staff, and that they feel that there's been a breakdown between management and staff working in partnership. What do you say to that, Professor Connell?
Okay. Well, firstly, I would return to what I said at the start, that I and my colleagues across the organisation are fully committed to partnership working. I think the board acknowledges that there were significant problems in earlier years, but I believe that these are now improving. And indeed, Paul Gray, the Chief Executive of NHS Scotland, made a specific comment at our annual review that he detected a substantial improvement in our partnership relationships. Okay.
But
since
partnership can be at a very high level, and that covers a number of outside bodies. These are individual members of staff who are frightened to raise grievances and are speaking in accordance to the RCN about the fear that they have on a daily basis.
In terms of culture, my view and that of my colleagues is that we would not tolerate a culture of bullying or adverse staff experience, and we are actively working with colleagues, including staff partners, to make sure that we do have a culture that is open and transparent and encourages staff to deliver the very best they can for the organisation. Over the last year, we've had a large amount of effort going into staff engagement. I personally, along with the Chief Executive, Medical Director and Director of Nursing, have been involved in a large number of or Value Your NHS staff meetings with large numbers of staff right across the organisation. I think I've personally been to 12 of these in the last year, when I've met staff in a variety of circumstances, including communities and in our inpatient facilities. On all of these, I have been impressed by the commitment of our staff, the genuine value they see in working for the NHS, and I've not had reflected back to me at that stage major concerns about staff bullying and harassment.
Professor Connell, I don't think anyone doubts the commitment of the staff, but the RCN are telling the committee in this written evidence that staff feel bullied. There is a culture of bullying. What do you say to that particular point?
If there was evidence of that, we would not tolerate it, but I'll pass to our chief.
So what will you do, having been made aware of it today?
Yeah, so the first thing I would say is that I was extremely disappointed to read that. As a nurse by background, I fully understand the work and the importance of staff feeling safe, that they can come to work to do the job, as Bob McGlashan said, that they got every day to do. So from my perspective, then, clearly there is further work to be done. We will take immediate action. So that was certainly the first time that had been brought to my attention. And I give a personal commitment that myself and my colleagues will be sitting down with RCN colleagues to understand this in more detail, and also give you the commitment, if there is any evidence of any feeling of fear or intimidation by any of our staff, we will take immediate action in relation to that.
Thank you, that's appreciated. Can I just pick up the issue of brokerage? We've heard from the Auditor General that if the Scottish Government wanted to, it could waive the brokerage and wipe the slate clean. Is that something the Board has asked Scottish Government to consider? No. Why not?
Because we recognise the financial pressures across all public sector organisations, and I think there are some factors in Tayside that we've described earlier that are making it more challenging for us, but it's not about us not having enough allocation of monies proportionately to every other health board and public sector organisation. And we are confident that there is money that we are having to either invest around, like, our ageing estate. You know, we have a large number of hospital sites that are over 30 years that are really costly, and we are really progressing our community and home-based models. So there will be a time where we will not require these inpatient facilities. That will release a lot of revenue in terms of our maintenance cost, our backlog maintenance, and we believe that through the service redesign work, we will be able to redistribute the money to support the financial pressures that we're currently experiencing. So overall, of course, it's challenging. We recognise that. But we are no different than any other board. And we have a big challenge in front of us, but we are absolutely committed to deliver.
So has the board debated the possibility that you might have to ask for the brokerage to be waived in the future?
No. Never.
No. OK. In terms of property, I'm glad you raised that, because at the last session, we picked up on the large number of properties that you're hoping to accrue some savings from. I think it adds up to £7.6 million, but you're not having a lot of success in the marketing of these properties. 13 have been marketed for over 1 year and 3 for more than 4 years. You've mentioned you've got other properties that are ageing and could be disposed of, but you're not having any success trying to dispose of the ones that are currently on your books. Could you give us an update on that?
So, I mean, if I may, I'll pass to Finance Director. He's got that.
Sorry, could you make concise as possible? That would be much appreciated.
Okay. By the end of March, we are looking to dispose of up to 14 of the properties. I guess, importantly, the sites that have been surplus to requirements for the longest period will be off our books by the end of March.
Will you achieve market value for those properties?
We'll receive open market value for those sites, and any property that has been disposed of has to be approved by the board. And in coming to the board, we also bring the professional advisors valuation on whether we are getting value for money from the sale of that property.
Have you rejected any offers on the basis that you're not getting best value out of the offers?
In the last financial year, we did. The board did decline an offer.
Just one offer?
It was only two or three properties that the board was looking to dispose of last financial year that physically came to the board for approval. I guess, importantly, the sites that will be disposed of this year will generate recurring revenue savings of approximately £400,000. And also, importantly, it will alleviate potential backlog maintenance costs of up to £1.8 million.
Mm-hmm. So the properties that you've received an offer for, what were they valued at? What was the value of the properties?
For the... In terms of the properties that will be disposed of this year, there are a valuation part that was included within the external auditor's report of close to £4.5 million. We expect to receive receipts of close to £2.5 million.
It was just to find out, I'd asked if an offer had been rejected on the basis that it didn't achieve market value. So what was the property valued at and what was the offer that you received?
The offer that we received last financial year was close to £500,000. The market, the assessment that we had in for that site was close to £1.5 million.
Thank you. Thank you. Ross Thompson.
Thank you very much, Convener. In the evidence session this morning, we heard about staff morale, and particularly how low that is. To quote Bob McGlashan, he said, "Staff morale is getting less and less. Staff do not feel valued. There is a big stress for the nursing family." To quote Raymond Marshall, "Admin staff have been an easy target. Staff are feeling frustrated and constrained, and that the relationship between managers and staff is not good, and in fact has gotten worse from previously before, and that there is now no trust." So with staff morale in tatters, is that not a direct result of the failure of management to address issues run about vacancies, run about bullying, as Monica Lennon has highlighted, which is, there's clear evidence of within the submissions, and your ability to communicate with your staff?
I'll again start the discussion. I think firstly, if we have evidence of bullying or major staff grievance, we want to hear about it. My experience in meeting staff is that does not accord with the statements made by RCN or Unison, that staff...
So are RCN making it up?
No, I don't think they are. But I think it is not as widespread as perhaps indicated to the committee. But I would pass to the...
I was extremely disappointed to hear that. You know, I have regular dialogue with the RCN, as does my nursing director, and I absolutely give the commitment that if there is any situation in terms of any bullying or harassment, that we will take immediate action on that. That is our track record.
Ross Thompson.
It perhaps proves the point that staff obviously feel they cannot communicate with management, which obviously has looked at. Anyway, following on from what we've also heard this morning, we were told that there has been no engagement with staff. And given that the audit report identifies you need to make workforce savings, what engagement will you ensure is in place to discuss with staff your transformation programme for the workforce? Because would you not agree that if you do not look after your foot soldiers, if you cannot command the confidence of your staff and command their trust, then you're simply going to set yourself up to fail with this?
Okay. Firstly, I wouldn't describe our staff as foot soldiers. I think they're valued partners in delivering healthcare to the population of Tayside.
Absolutely, and you're not valuing them at the moment.
They are valued. In terms of the transformation programme, firstly, I would point out that the employee director, who chairs our area partnership forum, sits on our transformation programme board. All the transformation programme detail is discussed at our area partnership forum, which I attend on every occasion. I have the minutes available if you wish to see them, which document detailed discussions of all the transformation programme plans and the work streams. So staff are engaged in that, and you've heard confirmation from the staff themselves that they're involved in the various work streams. So I think I would contest the fact that we do not have that dialogue in place through our area partnership forum, which is attended by all of our staff side unions and our managerial staff.
Thank you.
Convener, just to say thank you very much for that. It would be good if the committee, as has been highlighted, if there are minutes of any meetings, I think given the evidence we heard this morning about no engagement, lack of engagement, and staff feeling frustrated with it, I think we need to see the evidence of it. So if the committee could be furnished with it, I think that would be
very happy to provide you with all of those minutes.
I think that might be useful, Professor Connell, because if there is transparency around there, obviously there's two sides to every story, and that might shed a little light. Can I ask you a little bit about prescribing? Because Auditor General identified prescribing as a major problem in NHS Tayside for finances in her report last year, but she also identified the same issue the year before in October 2015 for the previous year. Now, I was at your annual review presentation in September, as you know, and at that presentation you showed a picture of Chief Executive and the Chair launching an initiative on prescribing just the week before, I think in September. Can you tell me why it's been so long from the Auditor General? You know, we've known prescribing's been an issue for a long time. Why it took till this September to launch that initiative?
So first of all, we're absolutely right. We did launch a prescribing campaign around waste management, but that was only one of six that I believe that we have undertaken in this calendar year. So we are doing a whole range of prescribing initiatives out with the media. We've got one just now out around the kind of stock up. We know just now, for example, that over the winter period, people stock up in excess medicines, I think across the board, somewhere in the region of about an extra £1 million. So
when you say people, Ms. McLeod, when you say people stock up on extra medicines,
patients,
do you mean,
you know, there's all people in terms of communication that goes out to the general public at the winter time, just reminding them. And of course, it's really important that the general public or patients have enough medicines to manage over the holiday period. But there is evidence that there is, and this is national evidence, that people actually stock up quite excessively their drugs.
But surely the prescribers and your doctors should make sure that they have enough medicines to get them through, you know, ample amounts, but not stockpiles of them.
Yeah, I mean, we're just looking in terms of the cost. We will see a spike over the December month, as my finance director is saying, that would cost somewhere in the region of about £1 million, but you don't see a reduction in terms of people either stocking up and then using less drugs.
Why are people allowed to... I infer from what you're saying, correct me if I'm wrong, that there's actually, they have more drugs than they need. Is that right?
I think there is some evidence of that.
Why are NHS staff allowing that to happen if you're tightening up on prescribing?
But if I can comment, that is in fact a Scotland-wide problem, and there have been initiatives launched in the last month by the Chief Medical Officer and by the Director of Quality to try to address this. I think it's a complex issue because in many instances patients can submit repeat prescriptions directly to community pharmacists, so it bypasses NHS staff. And of course the community staff pharmacists may not feel they have the empowerment to query whether a patient genuinely needs an additional prescription.
I mean, I know this stockpile is happening. I've seen it myself in Dundee with, you know, stockpiles of prescribed paracetamol, which we know is extremely expensive, stocking up in people's houses. But you say it's a problem across Scotland. I do appreciate that. But your own board papers say concern was again expressed that prescribing had been an issue for over 2 years. There was not a sense that this was in any way further forward, and there should be an understanding by now of why prescribing was an outlier. That's your own board papers, and the Auditor General said this is a specific problem in NHS Tayside. So why are people still being able to stockpile medicines?
Stockpiling medicine is only one element of it. It's clearly not, it's not the sole area. I think our chairman earlier talked about some of the quality prescribing that's going on in NHS Tayside that actually ultimately reduces the number of strokes, which we have evidence of, the number of liver transplants, etc. So there's clearly that element where we are using drugs that are high-cost drugs but actually have better outcomes for the individual patient. And I alluded earlier that there definitely are areas in Tayside, either through formulary non-compliance, so people going off formulary, so using more expensive drugs, or previous choices by our clinicians that are expensive where there are good quality alternatives. And those are the things that we are addressing at the moment. I think this year in particular, we will see a reduction in our secondary care prescribing costs. Our primary care prescribing costs are still a particular challenge. We have done some work this year where we have identified the 10 GP practices that have the highest cost. Now, that's an exploratory conversation because there will be multiple reasons, prescribing costs. Mm-hmm. And our community pharmacists and our pharmacy team are working with those GP practices to help to look at where their costs are and look at what the alternatives are. So there doesn't feel like there's a quick fix in this, but we are certainly addressing it.
Do you feel that you have the cooperation and confidence of clinicians to actually get a grip on this quickly?
I believe the commitment is there, and in secondary and primary care. I think when you're working with, you know, 60 plus GP practices in particular, they're extremely busy. We're all aware of that, and there is not a lack of will, indeed.
Okay. It does lead me to question why it's taken so long to kind of make any progress. Do you see any progress on this to date?
Yes.
You do. Do you have evidence of that?
Yes, our hospital prescribing costs have shown a fall in this current financial year, which is gratifying. In terms of our primary care prescribing costs, last week I attended a prescribing pharmacy huddle, which again was this, focusing very much on some of the issues that Leslie McClay identified, high cost pain prescribing. There's another simple example where our general practitioners use one drug, rosuvastatin, which is a commonly prescribed statin drug, which is now probably the most expensive in class as opposed to the cheapest in class. That has arisen for historic reasons. At one stage it was the cheapest in class, but I guess as with all drugs manufacturers, change prices.
Okay.
We need to now change our prescribing to reflect that.
Thank you, Professor Cornell. Agency nursing, we saw Audit Scotland reported a 39% rise last year in agency nursing costs, which I think was one of the highest in Scotland. And then you've told us this morning, and it's been reported, that this year there's been a 30% reduction. Now, given the amount of nurses that NHS Tayside employs, these are huge fluctuations. Again, Audit Scotland reported not this year, but last year, the agency nurse costs were a problem. So in that financial year, they were allowed to rise by 39%. Why was that?
Well, I mean, first of all, if we are using non-contract agency, that is to ensure that we deliver safe care. That's absolutely the first comment I would make. I think I've alluded to the fact that we have a number of hospital sites across NHS Tayside. We've got the largest number of hospital inpatient facilities, we believe, than any other board. Yep. And a lot of them are small community hospitals. And therefore, even if it's a low occupancy, there's still a required level of registered nurses required on a 24-hour basis, and these are driving our costs.
I appreciate that NHS Tayside has a large property portfolio in, you know, rural areas, and we have a lot of facilities that need to be staffed. But what we heard from the RCN this morning was that staff are actually turning their backs on NHS contracts and going across to agency because the terms and conditions are better. Is this not actually an issue of workforce planning within? Because we have a national health service in Scotland, but somehow we've created a market in nursing that should never, and I appreciate this is not just an issue for Tayside, but it is a specific issue for Tayside with this 39% increase.
Yes.
Is it not an issue of workforce planning and management planning to have prevented that?
I'm not sure we could have prevented it, but I agree workforce planning is really important.
So absolutely. Why hasn't that happened?
Well, if you go back to 2012-13, even into early 14, NHS Tayside was not a high user of non-contract agency, but just due to a number of factors in terms of vacancy factors. I also referenced the implementation of the nursing workforce tools that we were a very early adopter as a board, and that increased our whole time equivalent requirement substantially, and we have continued to deliver to that safe level.
Why more than other boards in Scotland, though?
I can't comment on the other boards. All I can comment is that we, in terms of the acuity of our patients, the number of wards that we have, and our safe staffing levels, that is what we resource to. It is only we've done a huge amount of work around our nurse bank this year. We have increased the number of nurses that are onto our nurse bank. So we now have gone from 800 to 1,200 nurses. And, of course, we are encouraging and looking at the flexibility that staff are wanting to ensure that our staff remain with us and don't go to the non-contract agency.
But, Ms. McLeay, even before you became Chief Executive, you were Chief Operating Officer in charge of all these issues. So surely you saw the trends, and why were measures not put in place so that it was actually NHS contracted nurses that you were employing rather than resorting to agency?
There was a number of measures that we've continued to put in place over the last 3-4 years. We continue to do that. We are dealing with a demographic situation, again, which is not similar only to, it's not just to NHS Tayside. There are a number of factors, but we are working as hard as we can to make our organisation as attractive as possible. The comments this morning from the RCN, as I said, clearly are disappointing. We will be addressing and looking to what we can do. We absolutely value our staff, and particularly our nursing staff,
and we
need to do more.
But did management take responsibility for these huge fluctuations in agency costs?
Of course we take. I mean, we're the senior management, and it is clearly our responsibility. I think what's important is the fact is that we have used 30% less non-contract agency to date at the same time we had in that financial year of 15-16, and we will continue to hold that position.
I would agree that's an improvement. It's the fluctuations that worry me with exactly the same team in place. Agency nurses, to my understanding, cost the taxpayer 3 times as much as a contracted NHS nurse. And as a public audit committee, it's our job to follow the public pound, and that doesn't seem to me to be a good use of the public pound, and certainly these huge fluctuations. I wanted to ask Lindsay Bedford. Lindsay, you told us earlier you've been with NHS Tayside for 33 years, so you have been in the finance team all that time, is that correct?
mainly. I did have an out at one point to a different specialty, but principally finance. Okay. Across the NHS Teesside.
So you have long experience of the financial issues that are experienced by NHS Teesside. I look back at the 2001, I think, audit of NHS Teesside when the Auditor General did a report then as well, and some of the issues that come up are actually quite similar to some of the issues today. Of course, you'll remember the Killshaw inquiry. That was about illegal payments, but it did lead me to wonder, if you were involved at the time in the results of the Killshaw inquiry, why have we seen such problems with the implementation of enhancement during leave payments?
As the Chairman said, in 2001, yes, I was in Teesside, but I was a relative junior member of the finance staff at that time, so I wasn't particularly involved in the outcomes or the discussions around the Killshaw report. The enhancements during leave resulted as a circular back in 2008. It's disappointing that, having received assurances that it had been implemented across Teesside in full, that the investigations subsequently occurred that it hadn't been implemented in full. And that recognises, I think, the complexity of the circular. I guess what was important is that when it was brought to our attention, that we did go through a fairly detailed process of understanding what the differences were between what had been paid against what should have been paid.
And just clarify, I mean, the EDL guidelines, enhancement during leave guidelines, were not implemented properly by NHS Teesside, is that correct?
Despite the assurances received by the Chief Executive, it turns out that they were not.
Okay, so you're saying that it was responsibility of a team below the Chief Executive to follow the guidelines correctly and they were not followed, is that right?
Through the individual line managers and down to the senior charge nurses who are responsible for putting the data into the system, then it turns out the circular hadn't been complied with. But that recognised, I think, the complexity of the circular, and is recognised within other boards across Scotland as well.
Is there an issue of governance there, Mr Bedford? If this was not, you said it was not picked up by the Chief Executive, is that correct?
Well, the assurances were given to the Chief Executive that the circular was being complied with. It was only when we did that detailed investigation, it turns out that, recognising the complexity of the circular, that the payments hadn't been made in full when they were on annual leave.
Ms McClay.
Yeah, I mean, as Mr Bedford said, we were, we were aware, we were obviously going back a number of years, but the assurance had been sought by the previous Chief Executive and myself, and as far as we were led to believe that we were fully compliant, when the detailed work was undertaken, there was found to be some errors in some areas. And that then led to the situation that we've since addressed.
Do the auditors have anything to say on this point about EDL payments and guidance not being followed over a period of time? Is this something you picked up, Tony Gaskin?
No, the issue first emerged in 2013, and as that was picked up, we were asked to look at the process that the board was using to address that. It wasn't something that we would have normally picked up through our audit work, no. When in that particular year there were 200 circulars came out, we don't follow every single one. What we do is, if there is a control weakness identified, we pick it up. What we do is look at the system that is used. So for every circular that is received by NHS Dayside, there is an instruction goes out, and at the point where a response is received from managers, then it's the responsibility of managers to implement that. Yeah, the board has exercised its duty.
Mr McClay, do you think this should have been picked up at an earlier point? Because it's now become a key issue for the Auditor General in the financial situation that NHS Teesside finds itself in now.
I mean, it's it's clearly disappointing to find a situation like that occurring, but there was no evidence that we were led to believe that there was any errors happening. It is a complex situation in terms of people determining what enhancements some would have during annual leave. I think what's important to say is that we now are in a position from the 1st of April where we will have an electronic system for our individual staff, and the e-rostering solution I referenced earlier will also help, because it will mean all our rosters are actually recorded electronically, which previously they were paper-based.
Should there have been a more robust situation in place? Lindsay Bedford said that you sought assurances from other teams. Should there have been better governance and a better system in place to actually give you the confidence that this system was being properly applied?
Well, I think we now have improved systems in. I think that's clearly important. We're addressing the situation, but at that time, as I said, there was no evidence. There had been benchmarking work undertaken by the previous finance director looking at our enhancements during leave that did not indicate that there was anything untoward in terms of our situation in Tayside. So there were a number of checks and balances looked at. However, there clearly was, and we did some further work around that to make ourselves absolutely assured, and that's when we found the errors.
You've seen improvements have been made, but it's just recently reported in the press that actually NHS Tayside is expected not just to run an £11.65 million deficit this year, but for that actually to increase to £18 million. So it's difficult for the committee to accept that all these improvements are happening when you're projecting actually an even larger deficit than Audit Scotland projected just 2 months ago.
I would just reiterate to the committee, in terms of our earlier statement from both myself and the chairman, that we have detailed plans that forecast that we will deliver on the £46.7 million.
Audit Scotland have drawn a big question mark over your ability to actually deliver these savings over a five-year period.
And you know, from our perspective on the work that we've done, we believe there is efficiency in the savings that we can make without impacting on the quality or patient experience, and that's what we intend to do.
Okay. Let me go back to the past. The 2001 report from Audit Scotland also identified a problem in NHS Tayside, that there was a heavy reliance on non-recurring savings. Now, we know that this is, again, a problem at NHS Tayside. So, Lindsay Bedford, with all your experience in the finance team, why has this reliance on non-recurring savings been allowed to happen again?
I guess over the years, it has actually fluctuated. Going back the last 4 years, it has been around about the 47-50% mark. But over the last couple of years in particular, that level of recurring savings level of recurring savings has fallen, and in part that just reflects the challenges that we faced. I think what I recognise as part of the financial framework going forward this financial year is that we need to look at things differently, and that's when the implementation of the workstream programme came to fruition. So rather than looking at individual groups and their budget efficiencies, then it was looked at more on a corporate level and driving through the efficiencies in very contained work streams. So it put a different focus on it. And also, as the Chief Executive and Chairman have mentioned, we talked about the value in your NHS sessions. So that kind of takes the conversations down to the individual staff members and the public around what, if they had to implement efficiencies then, what efficiencies would they see being made that would deliver efficiencies but also continue the same level of quality service?
But surely that's your job as a management team to identify those efficiencies and make those recommendations?
And indeed, that was the purpose of the initiation of the transformation programme and the workstream programme. So the implementation of the workstreams overseen by the Transformation Programme Board, of which a number of directors and non-executive directors are members.
Kenny Wilson, the internal auditor, when he gave evidence to our committee last month, said that there was a high risk of job losses as a result of this financial situation in NHS Tayside. Leslie McLay, why should hard-working staff bear the brunt of long-term financial mismanagement?
So your first comment, in terms of job losses, there is no forecast of job losses in NHST side by any of the plans that we're making. We are using the opportunity of our natural attrition rate, and through that there are some areas where we believe that we can redesign our services, and that will reduce the overall headcount, but this is not about job losses, absolutely not.
So can you guarantee the committee that in the plan that you produce in March and send to the committee, there will be no cuts to services or to job losses, that you will actually be able to find these huge savings from efficiencies within the system that we've already discussed?
So what I can say is, in particular to our workforce, there are opportunities, particularly in some of our admin and management areas, where we can redesign and do things differently. So that overall could reduce the headcount, but that headcount will be reduced through natural attrition by either people retiring or people are leaving. There is no intention whatsoever, there never has been, nor will be, in terms of cutting jobs. So there are different ways of doing it, and we will use, and we've got good examples of where technology is supporting us to do things differently that previously were done manually. So that will ultimately take down the head count reduction. In terms of cuts to services, we're not cutting services, but there are opportunities where we can deliver them differently, and the board will use that opportunity. But if we do that, we will do that. They will be clinically led, so our clinicians, our nurses, our doctors, our EHPs are helping us redesign them, and we'll be doing that in partnership both with our trade union partners, our staff and the public.
Okay, thank you. Can I go back to the issue of bonus payments? Ms McLeay, you confirmed that you had received a bonus payment for a fully acceptable performance. Is that correct?
Yes, that's correct.
And is that in the region of 1-3%?
For 15-16, it was 2.3%.
Mm-hmm. And Lindsay Bedford?
The same, 2.3%.
The same. And would your rating fully acceptable as well?
As I confirmed to Mr Kerr earlier, yes, it was.
It was. Given the state of finances at NHS Tayside, do you think these awards were merited?
In terms of my own award? Yes, I do. I think they were. I'm fully aware of the financial challenges that NHS Tayside has. I believe my performance was awarded on the work that I was doing as the leader of the organisation, and the work about building sustainable plans that were going to bring the board back into balance. That is what I believe reflected my performance.
Even though the Audit Scotland have drawn a question mark over whether you can actually make these savings?
I understand why they're questioning that. I think there's a whole load of questions around a number of boards in terms of their financial position. But from our perspective, I think the board is in a far stronger position than it has ever been in around having the five-year plan, the five-year financial plan, the detailed work we've done around our workforce profile, and the work we're doing with our integrated boards and our other regional partners to change the service models and continue to meet the demands of the patients in Tayside. I think it's a far stronger position than the board has previously been in.
Mr Bedford, given your role as finance director and your long experience at NHS Tayside, same question to you, do you feel that that award was merited and deserved?
So I've been in post since June 2016. The assessment that was done on me for last financial year, as already been said, it doesn't incorporate just finance, it incorporates another seven objectives on top of that. The Chief Executive made the assessment on my performance, and it went to the Remuneration Committee.
But your Financial Director, the Board projects, Audit Scotland projects an £11.65 million deficit this year. The Board itself projects an £18 million deficit. You've gone to the Scottish Government for loans to break even for the last 4 years. Looks likely that might happen again next year. Mr Neil pointed out that's 5 year savings of £214 million. Is that a sustainable financial situation for NHS Tayside?
I think the plan that we've discussed with the Scottish Government, as we touched on earlier, is seeking to repay that full financial brokerage over the remaining life of the five-year programme.
But in your opinion, is NHS Tayside in a financially sustainable situation?
I think with the work going on with individual work streams and the clinical strategies that will evolve over the next 12 to 18 months, then yes, I do.
But you feel that your performance merited that award?
I said my assessment was done by the Chief Executive.
Ms. McLeay, do you feel you have the confidence of staff to take forward the reforms that are needed to sort this situation out?
Yes, I do. I absolutely do. And I will make comment again around the comments that were made this morning that clearly were brought to my attention only through receiving the written submissions on Monday. Extremely disappointed, and I give a personal commitment that we will sit down with those individuals to understand the issues that they've raised with you, and a commitment that we will look to address them.
Professor Connell.
Yes, I pointed out to the committee right at the start, I've been chair since October 15, and I believe that Leslie McLeay does carry the confidence of the staff. She has the confidence of the board, as does the finance director. The finance director, as he has pointed out, was appointed only 3 months ago. So I believe that there is confidence that we have a chief executive and finance director who have identified correctly the issues that need to be addressed, and that I think is a major achievement. Have created a credible plan to address the situation, and have worked closely with Scottish Government and other regional partners to build a plan for the future, which does not put at risk delivery of safe healthcare for the population.
Thank you. Mr Bedford, do you feel you have the skills and confidence to get NHS Tayside out of this financial situation?
The information I provide is based on the plans for the individual work streams. So all I'm reflecting is the financial implications. So the work of the individual work streams will feed into any financial plan. So it's the credibility of the work done within the work streams that I will reflect within the financial plan.
Sorry, I was asking you personally as finance director, do you feel you have the skills and confidence to get NHS Tayside out of this situation?
And again, I guess I reflect on the work of the individual work streams that will feed into whatever I progress, but I do believe I have the skills and confidence to deliver on the financial sustainability of NHS Tayside.
You do. Okay. Thank you all very much indeed for your evidence this morning. We will consider the evidence at a future meeting and decide what other further action to take. Can I also thank the members of the public for attending and listening this morning? I now close this meeting of the Audit Committee.